Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.
All roads led to ITC Grand Maratha in Mumbai on March 12th. Naturally, it was the 11th National Convention of the Global Compact Network India. This prestigious event had business leaders, policy makers, global thought leaders and academicians coming together under one roof to discuss, debate and deliberate on how to achieve sustainable development goals as outlined by the United Nations Global Compact. The tone for the day was set by ONGC Chairman and Managing Director Dinesh Saraf. Mr. Saraf, who is also the President of the Global Compact Network India, outlined the theme, Broadening the Horizon for India's Growth and Transformation.
This year's convention, with the theme Sustainable Development Goals, Broadening the Horizon of India's Growth and Transformation, is the first such dedicated program on SDGs at this scale in India and perhaps anywhere in the world. Today, all of us here are ready to decide our individual and collective actions to contribute to the growth and development of our nations. All key stakeholders, government, civil society, and businesses are now shaping up and getting geared up to take leadership roles in ensuring that the three pillars, social, economic, and environment, are integrated at all levels of our action and performance. The role of businesses, however, will continue to be very vital in achieving the new 17-fold Sustainable Development Goals. I firmly believe that Global Compact and its universal principles will be aggregator, enabler, and fast tracker of these global goals and principles focused on environment, labor standards, human rights, and anti-corruption. Going forward, these focused goals will underpin the success of sustainable development in every nation. The 11th National Convention of Global Compact Network India, GCNI, comes at a very opportune time. I wish the 11th National Convention of Global Compact Network India a great success. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Taking a cue from Mr. Saraf, the convener of the event, Mr. Lalit Kumar Gupta, MD and CEO of SR Oil, talked about the 17 Sustainable Development Goals.
The world leaders in 2000 had set Millennium Development Goal, which were 8. The whole objective was to eliminate poverty. And building on these goals, in September 2015, they have set an agenda for 2030. And this is by way of 17 sustainable goals, and the main focus is people, planet, prosperity, peace, and partnerships. So on that, the whole idea is to eliminate poverty, to fight inequality and injustice, and to save the climate, or to control the climate change. So on that, this is the first national convention being held anywhere in the world after the UN has launched the sustainable goals. And the whole purpose of this conference or convention is to basically bring together, because this is the first time when the UN has said that they want to see partnership between public or the governments and the corporate sector. So the whole idea of this convention is to bring together all the corporates, academicians, social institutions, government together to spread this message that in next 15 years we have to achieve these 17 goals, and if we want to really give our children a better future, a better planet to live.
Seeing the upbeat mood, the policy makers too made a fervent plea. Maharashtra's Industry Minister Subhash Desai appealed to corporate India to support the various social sector schemes promoted by the Maharashtra government. The highlight of the day was a passionate speech by Union Environment Minister Prakash Javadekar. In his keynote address, he touched upon the government's initiatives and schemes which had achieved sustainable development goals.
The whole Swachh Bharat ka irada kar liya humne. That Swachh Bharat concept of Prime Minister has taken root. The whole 200 million people got included into the banking system with Jan Dhan Yojana, it's also a big step in sustainable development, because ultimately we have to eradicate poverty. So all these initiatives, housing for all and health and everything, are all in a sustainable development goals which have been adopted in New York. So last I'll just say one thing. As he said, we are providing ease of doing responsible business. Environmental governance, environment was a roadblock, unfortunately, for last 10 years. And what happened? I have calculated now last 20 months, we have given environmental approvals with adequate environmental safeguards to more than 900 projects, in which investment, which is unlocked now, is 6,40,000 crores. It's a huge investment which we have unlocked, otherwise it was locked. The earlier 10 years average of environmental clearance, to get environmental clearance, it used to take 600 days. Now we have come to 190 days and we are going ahead. We are going ahead, and I promise you that soon we will come to 100 days. You apply with full information, we'll give you an environmental safeguards, what you conditions to have the environmental governance, and then we will give you permission in 100 days. But that sustainability we have to think always. That sustainable development is our goal. Shoshan nahi hoga, dohan hoga. We have to use nature, not exploit nature. And to that end, we think nature and our life as one. Unless we think in that term, we can't achieve the goal of sustainable development. And I am sure that though India is not part of the problem, we will become a leader in providing part of solution. That's our commitment under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Thank you and all the best.
New York-based Ms. Lee Skingo was pleasantly surprised to see corporate India's overdrive and response. She said that the United Nations Global Compact's top priority was to translate sustainable development goals into responsible business action world over. Ms. Skingo was followed by other accomplished speakers like Udesh Kohli, Bhaskar Chatterjee and Puran Chandra Pandey.
If you really look at the 17 goals, you find that they can be put in three buckets. The first bucket is planet bucket, where you have to take care of the environment, Mother Earth, do no harm to the planet. Second one is people part. At whatever level you are, you have to really take care of the people, because they are very, very important for everybody. And then you have the prosperity part. Prosperity will mean that companies, NGOs, civil society, governments, they all will need to align their thought processes. They will all need to align to partner. And they will all need to align on those three agendas, people, planet, and prosperity, and do it.
On that note, it's time for a short break. Coming up after the break, it's a high-powered panel discussion on sustainable development goals, broadening the horizon for India's growth and transformation. Welcome back. In the high-powered panel discussion, CNBC TV 18's AB Ravi quizzed the brightest minds as to how to achieve sustainable development goals in a suitable time frame. This is what the experts have to say. Take a look.
In year 2000, you all started the Millennium Development Goals, and it went for 15 years. Now you all shifted your focus to SDG. What are the fundamental difference between the two? What have you achieved under MDG, and what do you propose to achieve under SDG?
Well, I think there's a big difference from when the Millennium Development Goals were created back in year 2000 to the new SDGs that have just been adopted. And I think one major difference is that very few people knew when the Millennium Development Goals came out several years ago. And as you mentioned, I have been working in business for more than 25 years. among other things, responsible for sustainable business.
Okay.
And it was a little bit of a surprise to all of us when the Millennium Development Goals came out.
Okay.
I think it's completely different with the new global goals, because multi-stakeholder processes has been going on for 3 years before they were adopted in September. And Global Compact here in India, but also in many other countries across the world, had interactions with business, with civil society, with many institutions to get input for what would constitute the new SDGs.
Okay.
So a lot has been done to create stakeholder involvement and awareness that something new would happen.
Okay.
So this summer, in the Global Compact, when we looked at a large sample of companies that are participants in Compact, it was already more than 70% that knew that the global goals were coming, and it was already more than 40% that said, I'm willing to include the SDGs into my business strategy. So I think we are at a completely different awareness level today with the goals.
Okay, let me get Vishwesh in here. Accenture has been partnering with GCNI for some time now. I believe you have done some CEO study on sustainability. So could you throw light on what was the study about and what is your findings?
The UAGC Accenture CEO study on sustainability is one of the largest studies on sustainability done.
Okay.
It covered more than 1,000 CEO surveys across 100 countries. And I want to take the next few minutes to share three key insights which came out of that study. The first insight related to the level of commitment. More than 90% of the CEOs we surveyed indicated that they believe that sustainability is crucial to the future success of their businesses. So that was the first finding.
Mm-hmm.
However, only 40% of the CEOs were able to articulate the business benefits of sustainability. And these companies are those companies which we call have reached the trust sweet spot. Now, the trust sweet spot is an area where the business benefits and the societal benefits converge. And that's why they're able to realize or articulate the business benefits of sustainability. And the third key insight was that the CEOs are really looking at support from government, they're looking at support from civil society to really take forward the sustainability agenda. The support specifically they're seeking from the government largely is around policies and creation of an enabling environment. And the support they're seeking from the civil society is in terms of forging partnerships to drive on the ground implementation.
Today there are 17 goals. But when Kofi Annan set up the United Nations Global Compact, the thematic area was human rights, labor, environment, and anti-corruption. And I think all the four holds good even today. So let me start with, let's say, anti-corruption. Business, according to the United Nations Global, United Business should work against corruption in all its form, including extortion and bribery. Is it practically possible?
Yes. And
the cost of being upright corporate citizen, how do you put this to practice, or shall I say reduce practice, of corruption or bribery? How successful are Indian companies here? Can this be wished away?
Already in our country, there are systems, processes, procedures, which is very clear about the corruption, how it can be controlled. So in that organization, what you need to have the processes to be built in line with the stipulation, point number one. Point number two, again, IT has given us the opportunity of doing online vendor specification, online bidding, so that removes corruption to a great extent. Thirdly, corruption in case of anything needs to be identified, law has to take that course, and the penalty has to be on that. I think with these three, corruption can be controlled, and I'm proudly say that not only in my company, even in India, we are going ahead.
Okay, let me get a big group like this, sir. How do you tackle this? It's a reality, actually. You can't just wish it away. You can only reduce the...
If you look at India or anywhere in the world, if you see how, from a developing, underdeveloped nation to a developing nation, this is a transition. And you know, I think there are various levels of corruption which all of these economies face, and the levels or the nature of corruption could be very different. So in my view, I think the biggest game changer for corruption is going to be IT, because it will open up everything, transparency, making open systems. So that is number one. Number two is to remove scarcity. Say, for example, I remember when we were young, you know, there used to be scarcity of almost everything. So there was a corruption in everything, whether you had to get a phone connection or a gas connection or a power connection or a car or anything. There used to be a black market for all of these things, because there was scarcity.
Demand supply mismatch.
The moment the demand supply mismatch goes away and market forces are playing, all of this goes away. So I think which reduces a huge, big number, a big amount of corruption. Now we talked about Aadhaar, where the subsidies are going to go straight to the bank accounts, the financial inclusion. You know, that will take away another huge level of corruption which happens at various levels in our system. So I think these are things, and then, you know, some of these things are habit forming, you know, that, okay, if that's the way people are working, that's the way it is happening, so it goes on like that. But once it changes, you know, there is no scope for corruption.
Okay, let me get Vishwesh. The second theme is the environment. Okay, in the case of environment, we know what's happening in China. We know happening in Japan what had happened. But in India, Delhi, we saw the air quality index, what they call ACI, air quality index. I think it is worth something more than 300. And so is Mumbai. So how do we tackle these environment challenges? And who will take the lead here, the corporate or the government? And will the role of technology help you?
You know, the last 12 months, there's been a lot of awareness. And you're absolutely right about the pollution levels in Delhi. 2.5 parts per million particulate matter is actually in the hazardous zone for a city like Delhi. So very clearly, I think, to answer your question, who's going to take the lead? I think it's going to be a multi-stakeholder approach. And, at one level, very clearly, if I was to really talk about the citizens themselves, the civil society, right, how do we change our culture? How do we change our behaviors? Recognizing that, look, we are borrowing from the future. So really, it really starts by that. But that actually then needs to be incentivized or disincentivized. And that's where government comes into the play in terms of creating policies which creates incentives for using public transportation versus private transportation. And then comes the question of capacities, you know, in terms of creating that infrastructure which is available for the citizens to change their behaviors. So, you know, the issue is complex, but the issue is solvable. And to answer your question, Ravi, once again, technology plays a very important role. So how do you create app-based systems which actually make the commute very friendly, which actually allow citizens to share in a very safe and secure manner their transportation with people whom they don't even know. Okay. So I think these kind of systems are available, and it's just a question of a multi-stakeholder approach, recognizing that, look, this is an issue which we have got to solve together and kind of make life better for all of us today as well as for the coming years.
Talk about labor. According to the UN Charter, it says business should uphold the freedom of association, the effective recognition of the right to collective bargaining, effective abolition of child labor, elimination of discrimination in respect of employment and occupation. But the heart of the matter is labor. We saw what happened in Maruti. We saw what is happening in public sector bank. It's a political issue. So how do you tackle?
Look, in our case, it's actually the other way around, because people are a raw material. So when, people go home, our biggest wealth is that, and we want them to come next morning. So we are geared up to ensure that labor is happy. We are providing the adequate recognition and rewards. Companies like us and others always take part in the best companies to work for. So for us, of course, because it's a service industry and because labor is so key, we ensure that our labor is well taken care of. We have no choice. We also ensure, because we are hiring security people, we are hiring drivers, even people on contract labor, all the rules and regulations are met. PFESI is given. Because as the primary organization, and because our reputation is based on how we treat people, I think we take a lot of care on that.
Okay, Parag, we are coming to the fourth theme, that is human rights. Now, according to UNGC Charter, again, they say that, can business be champion of safe childhood for every child? So, how do you build an environment conducive for children? Do you think CSR will help you?
Yes, indeed. I mean, you are asking the question, can business be? I think business has to be. We are an important stakeholder in society, and we must act as leaders. So, and especially in developing nations like ours, then we have a big role to play. And we must insist within our companies, of course, I'm sure most of the companies do, not to employ child labor, have equal practices. But we must go so far as to put this in a whole supply chain. So in our case, we have a code of conduct also for our suppliers, wherein we mention very clearly that they're not supposed to employ child labor, and we are ensuring that by audits and by regular training sessions with them as well. And then on top of that, I think all of us as individual citizens have a big role to play here. And we are trying to facilitate that in our company by bringing volunteers together to go out and educate, let's say, the contractual labor who are working on building sites, to help them to educate their kids, take them out of manual labor and provide education facilities for them. We do that in terms of having mobile buses, by trying and going and holding training sessions in labor camps. So here I think it's not just us as a corporate citizen, but also as an individual citizen who has a big role to play.
Please, India ranks number one in the Asia and Oceanic region where sustainability is concerned. We rank number 10 globally. I think Spain is number one. What do you think India has to do to get there to number one rank?
I think first maybe creating a really powerful national SDG plan where all your ministers see their role, and it's made like a systemic plan, because the SDGs cover everything in society. And then I think convincing business to play their role, as we spoke about today, having the schools play another very important role, having journalists like yourself talk about this in a easy and bold way through the media. I think it has to be a mobilization of all the channels and all the forces in society. Then you would get a holistic plan, and if you could even measure it and manage it, as many of the panelists have been speaking about, I think that would be the recipe for becoming number one.
Okay, very well. Thanks a lot.